Thank you. Thank you very much. So good afternoon, Portland, Maitripa. I miss Rinpoche sitting there. I know he's not feeling well. The first time I came here, I was shocked that he was actually going to be here through my talk. But now I miss him. So it's nice to be back here. I'm glad to be able to see you, at least for a little bit. And how many of you are regular students here? Wonderful. Good. It's a good opportunity that you have, isn't it? So I want to talk to you a little bit about the path and a little bit about different aspects of the path. And particularly, I'm going to talk to you from the perspective of a particular text by Longchen Rupchum, the great 14th century brilliant theoretician of Dzogchen and writer of many amazing hundreds of texts, actually over 300, and of one very small text known as the Seven Mind Trainings. So it's a Semjong or a Lojong text, but it's different, as you will see, from the Atisha-based texts with which you might be familiar. But after all, our business as practitioners is training our minds. And training our minds means that we are practicing chö, dharma, in order to chö, cut the afflictions. My teacher, Ketsen Sambo, said that in some lectures in California many years ago, and I have taken to repeating it because it's very nice. You can easily remember that, right? So the purpose of our practicing, we have to train our minds because even though we're totally pure in nature, even though our Buddha nature, our Tathagata Garbha, our true nature, what we really are, is as perfect as it ever will be, even after we finish the path. Even though that is the case, still, we have to practice because we have all kinds of hobgoblins of mental apparitions that are floating in the vast sky of our immense purity and which obstruct the view, our view, of our nature, bless you, and of what we really are. So we train the mind, and these seven mind trainings are ways of training the mind so that we can see and actually experience and understand our real nature, our reality, so that we can die and recognize it as we pass through the bardo of the Dharmata when the clear light of death arises, and we aren't just stunned and amazed and worried and freaked out, but we actually see that what is dawning is the very nature that we have been practicing all our lives to experience more clearly. Is that familiar? Recognizing that we have this pure nature is quite an important thing, particularly in the Nyingma presentation of Dzogchen, but it's actually an important theme in all of the Buddhist traditions. Even before the Mahayana, there were at least statements, I believe, in the Anguttara Nikaya that the nature of the mind is clear light, something like that. So this pure nature that we have means the highest tantra, Uttara Tantra, says that when we recognize this, or even when we start to understand that there is this nature, Gampapa says that just as surely as if you churn milk, you will get butter, because it's in the nature of milk that it will produce butter if you do the right things to it. And you don't have to add anything to the milk, is the point. It will produce butter. It's in its nature. So we human beings, we will produce full experience of enlightenment as long as we get stirred in the right way. And our practice is how we stir ourselves in the right way so that we can experience this which we have always been and always will be. And so a Sangha in Uttara Tantra makes the point that this is actually wonderfully reassuring. And Longchenpa quotes this material in his Treasury of Philosophical Tenets, one of his famous seven treasures, also so that we gain confidence. And Asim Rinpoche, in teaching this text, emphasizes we practice in full confidence of our capacity for enlightenment, and not only our capacity, but actually it's already, the hard work, so to speak, is already done. Actually, it wasn't any work at all. In fact, you can't create this nature. It's natural. It's a principle of our existence that it occurs. And so we recognize in some way, at least intellectually, we have this sense that our practice is really not about creating some goodness that we don't already have. Our practice is very much about getting out of our own way. Our practice is about purifying and relieving ourselves of all of these obscuring veils that prevent us from seeing what is already here. So there's a tremendous confidence in that. It's not like we have to worry about whether it's possible or not. It's already done. The money's in the bank. You just have to learn how to sign your name. So we are learning how to sign our true name by experiencing our true nature, and then we will see what has always been true. And Longchenpa and Jigme Lingpa in the 18th century, a very significant figure who has visions of Guru Rinpoche and also of Longchenpa himself, when he follows Longchenpa and Guru Rinpoche by doing retreat at Samye Chimpuk. Anybody been to Samye Chimpuk? Above the hills, the legendary hills above Samye, just behind Samye Monastery, where pretty much everything that was important happened in Tibet. Guru Rinpoche taught his first 25 disciples there. King Trisong Detsen did meditation there. Yeshid Sogyal visited there with Guru Rinpoche. And Longchenpa, when he came to Samye Chimpuk, he famously said, "This is such a wonderful place. I think it is better to die here than to be born anywhere else." And he did die there. And his stupa is still there. And there's a cave, there are a couple caves, but especially the flower cave in Lower Chimpuk, where Longchenpa meditated and also Jigme Lingpa meditated. And it's still there so far, still there. Nobody has desecrated it. And one can go there. And so in these caves, they had tremendous visionary experiences. Jigme Lingpa had tremendous visionary experience of Longchenpa. And out of the accumulation of his experience of retreat at Chimpuk and also elsewhere, he revealed, he was a Tertön, the tradition known as the Longchen Ningtik, the heart essence of the vast expanse. And this takes its place as the most recent, in a way, of the famous Ningtik traditions. These are the Nyingma traditions of Dzogchen, which do cross-fertilize in significant, interesting ways, actually, with Gelug. Tulku Chunup told me that the at Dzogchen Monastery, and also, I believe, at Gatok, they actually studied Zhangya and Jamyang Sheba. Has anybody studied Zhangya and Jamyang Sheba, the great Siddhantists of the Gelug tradition? They study tenets of these great Gelugpa authors as a basis for their Dzogchen. And of course, the fifth Dalai Lama and the present Dalai Lama also have a very strong connection with Dzogchen, and my own teacher, Geshe Wangyal, who was educated at Drebung, and who was a very, very much, of course, taught within the Gelug tradition. And many of my teachers throughout, especially my first decade or so of studying and university and dissertation and so forth, were, you know, the great Gelug geshes of the 20th century that His Holiness the Dalai Lama handpicked and sent to University of Virginia, of course, so that we could study with them. And the more I studied that and the more I became acquainted with the Nyingma tradition, also I began to see, for me personally, there's just a beautiful interweaving there. So just want to be very clear that I speak as someone who reveres, has studied, and been very, very close to a number of amazing Gelug teachers, especially Khenso Yeshe Tup, Lolan Khenso Yeshe Tup, Ladi Rinpoche. And so when I speak of Nyingma, I'm not speaking in any kind of partisan way. I just felt that that's something that I might talk about that perhaps you hear about less here. That's all. So the within Nyingma, within the Dzogchen tradition, so just as within Gelugpa, the highest tradition, Anuttara Yoga Tantra. So all of the four Buddhist traditions of Tibet, as I think you know, have their own highest teaching. And within Nyingma, it is Dzogchen. Burn also has Dzogchen, Kargyu has Mahamudra, Sakya has Lamdre, and as His Holiness the Dalai Lama says in an amazing piece, if you haven't already read it, called The Pinnacle of All Vehicles, it's in a volume called Dzogchen, edited by Sogyal Rinpoche. It's actually the Dalai Lama's talk in October 1989 in San Jose, just after being awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. And everybody who attended that talk is still talking about it. It's just amazing. He goes through the entire path, starting with the study of mind training, Lorik, study of mind, study of reasoning. He goes through pramana, sama, talks about valid cognition. Then he goes on to talk about tantra. And then, towards the very end, he makes a move to talk about Dzogchen in relationship to highest yoga tantra in Gelug. And it's just it's a whole education in and of itself, that one. It's called The Pinnacle of All Yanas, and it's in that book called Dzogchen. So, in Nyingma, the highest teaching is Dzogchen, and the Dzogchen traditions began in Tibet with the Bima, it's called the Bima Nyingtik, which is related with Vimalamitra, and then the Pema Nyingtik with Guru Rinpoche, Pema Guru Rinpoche, and then that was actually hidden for many years, while the Bima Nyingtik was the main one that was practiced. And then Longchen Rupcham was regarded as the reincarnation of the princess, the daughter of Chisung Daitsen, who died at the age of 8 years old at Samye Chinpuk, and was revived by Guru Rinpoche just long enough to implant in her the seed of what would become the Pema Nyingtik. Because until she, this princess, would be reborn many centuries later, as first Pema Ledrosel and then Longchenpa in the 14th century, the Bima Nyingtik was the main one, and then there was the Pema Nyingtik, and then Longchenpa, Longchen Rupcham, sort of codified all of them in his amazing writing known as the Nyingtik Yashi, it's called the four-part heart essence, and it contains the Bima Nyingtik, the Pema Nyingtik, commentaries on both of those, and then a synthesis of the two of them. And this is considered some of the greatest Dzogchen writing ever. So if you ever get an interest in Dzogchen, you can pray to hear a few lines from these amazing teachings. Now, Jigme Lingpa, meditating the same cave as Longchen Rupcham, has visions of Longchen Rupcham, and eventually is inspired. He has a vision that he's flying over Bodhinat, the stupa at Bodhinat, and the Dakinis hand him some yellow scrolls, out of which he is able to interpret what becomes the Longchen Nyingtik, heart essence of the vast expanse. So this is a more modern iteration of this ancient lore of Dzogchen, going back to the early glory days of Buddhism in Tibet, 18th century. And Adzom Trukpa in the 20th century has visions of Jigme Lingpa at Adzom Gar in what is now Sichuan. And he writes about this very briefly, actually, in his is quoted in his biography, and he says that Jigme Lingpa was very, very kind. Very kind. So why am I telling you all this? So that you will have some sense of the deep background of this very short text by Longchen Rupchum, The Seven Mind Trainings, which is commented on by Jigme Lingpa in a work called Stairway to Liberation. And Cortland Dahl has translated that, hasn't published it yet, but it will be published, and it's definitely worth reading. And what I want to explore with you today is the way in which Jigme Lingpa, in commenting on this text, actually makes, for example, the first training, which is all we will talk about today, the training on understanding impermanence, how he makes this, what I would say, a nine-vehicle view, hence. So nine vehicles. All of the traditions within Buddhism have their own ways of marking out the stages of the path. Tsongkhapa makes, of course, the Lamrim genre famous. And within Nyingma, they talk about nine vehicles. The first three vehicles are the sutra vehicles, the hearer, Partaka Buddha, and Bodhisattva vehicles. The middle three vehicles are the outer tantric vehicles, action, performance, and yoga tantra. And then the last three are Maha, Anu, and Ati, with Ati, which means highest, being Dzogchen. And they are the three subdivisions of what, in the Gaelic systematization, you would call highest yoga tantra. Make sense? So the point is that these have different... These three, if we talk about the outer, inner, and secret vehicles, the outer being the first three sutra ones, the inner being the outer tantras, the lower tantras, and the secret being Maha, Anu, Ati, and Dzogchen. So these vehicles have slightly different ways of going about things, as you're probably quite familiar with. In the sutra vehicle, it's a matter of applying an antidote. If you are blazing with hatred, cultivate love. If you are dull with stupidity, study dependent arising, for example. Overwhelmed with an idea of self, analyze it. See if you can actually find it. Apply the antidote. In Tantra, there's more of a metaphor of transformation of energy, the use of mantra, of course. Devotion, extremely important all along, but perhaps particularly important in Tantra and devotion to one's teacher. And in Dzogchen, it's really just liberation, right? No need to apply an antidote or transform anything because we go back to the basics and the Buddha nature neither needs an antidote nor does it need to be transformed. Just need to be revealed, just need to see it. So these are slightly different strategies. And what is very beautiful and significant about the way Jigme Lingpa puts this together, and I think the main message for us, is that all of these three strategies are mutually complementary. That's very, very important. So once we start to learn about Tantra, we don't forget about using what we learn in all of the teachings of ethics and compassion and so on that are there in the sutra tradition. We don't forget about that. We don't forget about them either when we are introduced to Dzogchen. Just because we have a Buddha nature doesn't mean we don't have to watch our tongues when we speak. You know, we still have to mind our behavior, because we can't count on our pure nature to reveal itself in all of our activities unless we pay attention and do a little of this chi with the chi that we are, the Dharma that we're practicing. So how does Jigme Lingpa go about this? Well, first of all, this text, The Seven Trainings, is until the seventh training, which is somewhat esoteric in nature, it's really a review content-wise, we can say it's pretty much a review of what we know of what Tsongkhapa talks about in the first volume of Lamrim Chimo, what we do in the beginning of the foundational practices, recognizing the preciousness of our human life, recognizing its fragility and impermanence, recognizing that even when we die, that's not the end, it's not like good enough, there's more, we go on, there's the cause and effect of karma, and also the importance of practice in our lives. So this is of the importance of developing compassion, of really being committed to practice, of being devoted to one's teacher, of actually following one's teacher's instructions, and being absolutely committed to the path to enlightenment. These are the foundational aspirations that any practitioner has to train in, and this is what the seven trainings involve, at least the first six. As I said, the seventh gets a bit esoteric. And these might seem like pretty common sutra type of teachings. So how is it? Too interesting. In addition to what Jigme Lingpa does with this, which is the main thing I'm going to talk about, is the way Longchenpa himself frames this text. It's a very short text. And in a guide to his own writings that Longchenpa wrote toward the end of his life, he organized his own teachings, his more than 300 plus teachings, into which ones one should start with and what one should read if one wants to know this or that. And his last little grouping of texts is what you should read if you want to know the essence of the entire teaching. Now this from the person who wrote the, I think, 14-volume Ning Tik Yap Shi that I just mentioned that contains the entire history of Dzogchen, the Vima Ning Tik, Pema Ning Tik, commentaries on those two. So he knows, when he's talking about essence of the teaching, he has a lot of teaching in mind. He was the greatest scholar of his day. He had really assimilated centuries worth of material. And he said, one of the four things that you should read if you really want to know the essence is this little text, these seven trainings. That's how important he felt it was. He frames these, and Jigme Lingpa also makes this very clear, that these are the opening avenue to Dzogchen practice, these teachings. So we might ask, how does reflection on impermanence, which is, of course, not even a Mahayana teaching, right? Everybody, all Buddhists study impermanence. How does this prepare us for Dzogchen, the highest of all teachings? So we want to consider this. It's really a kind of koan, I think. Impermanence. What do we mean by impermanence? If you study the debate texts, I don't know, do you study this here? Somebody's smiling, maybe you do. So do you know the definition of impermanent? Thank you. Oh, gechigma, indeed. Momentary. Defining characteristic of impermanence is that which is momentary. Momentary means changing from one moment to the next. Is this what you want out of life? Changing from one moment to the next? That is a description of the first ennobling truth, isn't it? The truth of unsatisfactoriness. Change is for us, we are creatures who want certainty. We don't want things changing all the time. The weather, okay, it was cold and now it's beautiful today. Okay, that kind of change, okay. But you know, your friends, you don't want them turning on you, and you certainly don't want them getting older and dying. And yet, this is inevitable. Your house, you want to feel it will always be there. Your clothing, your pets. We are all creatures like that. But impermanence is a slap in the face of what we want. Impermanence means everything, the greatest beings who ever lived in the past, none of them are here today. Great mountains that once were are now at the bottom of oceans. Oceans are now at the top of mountains. And so you find fossils in the Himalayas because they were once under the ocean. That always knocks me off my chair. Oh, you mean there's that much change? You can't rely on anything? So when Longchenpa talks about change in this first training on impermanence, how to train on impermanence, he talks about outer, inner, and secret impermanence. None of which is something we don't know. But when somebody like Longchenpa says, this is the essence of the teaching and the basis for your Dzogchen practice and hence your enlightenment, we sit up and listen in a very particular way. Oh, so Longchenpa says, so what is the outer impermanence is like the changing of the seasons. Very dramatic here in Portland. It's foggy and rainy. And then the leaves change color. That's a big thing. And then they drop off, and then it's cold and even more rainy. And then one fine day, spring, and the flowers come out, and our moods change, and we feel that the whole world is different, that we know about this change. The seasons change. Spring turns into summer, summer turns into fall, and so on. And not only that, night turns into day. So these little changes can sometimes make a big difference. External change. Then internal change, it starts to get more personal. It starts to get more personal. You notice that you are also changing. You're getting older. You are not the way you used to be. Hair's not the same color. Skin's not as unwrinkled. Can't sit up as long or straight or walk as fast or run as much or stay up as late into the night, practicing, partying, whatever it is that used to keep you up at night. You don't do it quite as much anymore. So that's the internal, coming in a little closer. Noticing that people really, really close to you are also subject to impermanence. And then the secret, there are different ways of talking about the secret, but what I found most compelling was Ajahn Rinpoche glossing, in teaching this text, glossing the secret impermanence as the rising and ceasing of your own thoughts. They too are impermanent. Not just your thoughts, but your great life-bending passions. You know, you turn yourself inside out for something or someone for some reason or other, and then you don't. It changes. It may last for moments, years, months, years, decades, but then changes. So that means that the very basis of our sense of who we are as beings, namely our feelings, our emotions, changes. What does that say about the kind of beings that we are? That really opens up our sense of questioning to our the solidity and confidence with which we hold to our identification of ourselves as ordinary people, whatever our name is. This is who I am, this is what I am. And when we are identifying with a feeling or a purpose, we really aren't in touch with. Identification means, experientially, when you're identified with something, it's like it will never change. This is it. This is who you are in love, in hate, frightened about your exam. You know, this is your identity at that time. And unless you have cultivated, if you've cultivated some sense of impermanence, and you know, well, this too will pass, this too will fade, this is not who I am, well, then who am I? And you start looking for something that you really, really are that isn't going to change. And you start peeling away the layers of the onion and pulling out the threads of the ball of yarn that you call me. And you can't find anyone that isn't subject to change. And that can be frightening, can be freeing, a sense of freeing. It's often, I think, a little bit of both. You know, phew, oh boy, am I glad that that's not really, really me. But then this other thing, well, wait a second. You know, if I'm not that, then I don't know. Maybe I don't have any real identity. Ooh. That's kind of scary. And it's kind of glorious because it means that I can begin to envision being free from all of these limiting factors that are hooked into my sense of being X type of person. Expert in this, lousy at that. But at least it's an identity. Something to wrap my mind around and say I about. And we feel we have the need to do that. And truly, so long as we don't actually recognize our real nature, which is vast and expansive, Jigme Lingpa said the heart essence, which is the vast expanse. It's often the translated heart essence of the vast expanse. It took a turn to point it out to me, and I footnoted it somewhere in my Heart Essence of the Vast Expanse book. He said I had to call it that because it's now so famously known as Heart Essence of the Vast Expanse. But Jigme Lingpa actually glosses it as heart essence. That means the essence, the key essence of what you are is a vast expanse. It's a way of glossing Buddha nature, a vast immensity. And that can be challenging for us to consider, because you can't grab onto anything in a vast expanse. That's kind of the point. So you can't hold on to a small sense of self in the same way that we do. We think there's security in that, but actually there's bondage in that. You know, if you've ever had a moment, and I'm sure you've had many moments, of just being able to give up some reaction pattern that you have, whether it's nervousness or jealousy or attachment to one thing or another, you know, it used to be, I just absolutely had to have an ice cream sandwich after lunch. I had to. And one usually wasn't enough. But now I don't. Somehow I'm free of that, you know? And at the time it seemed like, oh, this is who I am. I'm an ice cream sandwich eater. I know what to do after lunch. Gives me a certain shape to my otherwise formless being. But when I no longer have to do that, well, okay, then I'm a little free. That's kind of better, really. But when I'm in the grip of it, I don't want to be free of my need to have ice cream sandwiches, and I don't want to be told that there aren't any more left either. And so if there aren't, then I'm angry or I'm disappointed. So I have my whole reactive pattern built on this thing that is part of my sense of self, even a small thing like ice cream sandwiches. And we all have our little predilections. The world doesn't give them to us, then it's an affront to who we are, because we think that who we are is a consumer of that particular thing. And we do, we do, all of us. So understanding impermanence helps us to crack that open. The imprint on the mind of understanding impermanence is huge. It makes us recognize that our time is limited. So we better figure out as best we can what is important. How much time do you think you have left? And do you have a guarantee? Do you have a 5-year guarantee? So what's important? This is a very squirmy kind of topic, right? Because we know it's true. There's some limited amount of time, and the older you get, the more poignant this becomes. But you still don't know how much time it is, and you still don't know for sure, perhaps, what it is you should be doing. But whatever it is you should be doing, it should definitely be something that is helping you overcome the afflictions. Whatever it is, whether it's good works, helping other people, whether it's your strictly speaking meditation practice, making aspirations for the benefit of other beings. Definitely what we need to be involved with is something that is of benefit to our path, which is the making of ourselves into someone who can be of maximum benefit and of benefit to others. And really, I challenge you to think of another greater purpose. As Shantideva famously says, we have been calculating since beginningless time how to get more for us. Buddha has given all of that up and works only for the benefit of living beings. And look at the difference between enlightened Buddhists and ourselves. Who's happier? So when we think of happiness, in the real happiness, happiness that's really a state of sustainable, not giddiness, but you know, sustainable well-being, open-heartedness, connection with other people, doing something of meaning. We are beings who really care about meaning, aren't we, human beings? We don't like to feel that our lives are meaningless. So when we, as we think about impermanence, we are really enjoined to, okay, then, if time is limited, what will I do? What will you do? You, in this next year, what will you do that's meaningful? How will you refrain from frittering away your mind and energy in Facebook? Guilty as charged. You know, but it's okay, you watch some Facebook, so I'm not saying don't relax. I'm not saying don't ever relax. You need to relax, of course. But what purpose do you have that you want to keep in mind? We are capable of naming a purpose and keeping it in mind. But if we don't have a goal, we won't keep it in mind and we won't make sure that we have time for it. All desires are not the same, Hazen Rinpoche said when somebody once asked about, well, but aren't you supposed to give up all desires? Well, give up the bad ones first. All desires are not the same. The desire to study the Dharma, the desire to do good in the world, the desire to have a more open heart, the desire to be a person who creates positivity around you in your life and for your family. It's okay. You can have that desire. Finally, you will be able to give it up. Because it goes like this, and this I think is part of Jigme Lingpa's point, as we will see in a moment in a different way. So impermanence enjoins us to really name your priorities and keep your focus on the priorities. And two, impermanence, as we've already seen, it begins to undermine the sense of a solid, stable, ongoing, i.e. extremely important center of the world, me. Because you're just one thought arising and ceasing, and the waves in the ocean arising and ceasing, and where's the ocean except for those waves? And it's big, and it's powerful. So impermanence leaves a huge imprint in the mind in terms of undermining the very sense of having a me to grasp onto. And that is really important, because so long as we have a me to grasp onto, we have an other that we are cut off from. The sense of I and self and other, as Shantideva famously talks about, they create each other. As long as we have a sense of being some tiny, unprotected, little, living, flotsam or jetsam, you know, careening around this vast universe, totally out of control, of course we're going to be nervous. And of course we're going to see the world as a place where we either have to grab and get what we want before somebody else does, or we have to push away what will harm us. Once we locate ourselves as a self, what we might call an ego, that's inevitable. Desire and hatred follow suit, which is why what the Buddhists always say, right? Ignorance is a basis for desire and hatred. Can't help it. Once you're just this little thing in this vast world, you've either got to stick up for yourself by hating what's affronting you, or you have to get more to fill you up, because you're just this empty little bubble floating around, and you need, because you don't realize that you already have. You already are everything. But you don't can't realize that. As long as we don't realize that. So Longchenpa and Jigme Lingpa say, more on this theme of Buddha nature, that unless we realize something about our Buddha nature, we won't be sufficiently dissatisfied with the status quo, we'll just think that that's the way it is, to really be motivated on the path. So the discussion of Buddha nature is something very important for galvanizing us. Yes, it's possible. And two, no, the way we are right now isn't the end of the story. Needn't be, shouldn't be the end of our story. We can train, because our real nature is ready to reveal itself. And we already have a love for it. We already have a yearning for it. All of the beautiful melodies in the Tibetan tradition, all the traditions have, calling the Lama. You know that genre of the calling the Lama, longing for the Lama, like Jigme Lingpa weeping in his cave because Guru Rinpoche wasn't right in front of him. And then, of course, he has a vision of Guru Rinpoche. Missing our teachers. Some of our teachers have passed on. We miss them. But really, 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 the ultimate teacher is reality itself. And longing for the teacher in physical form is a way of expressing our longing for experiencing the reality to which the teacher is always pointing. All of the teachings, all of the teachers are always pointing to that. And that's what we miss, because this is our true love. This nature is our true love. It is a reliable love. It is not impermanent like all the other ones. It is not subject to decay. And opening to the vastness through allowing an understanding of impermanence to begin to dissolve this holding to something that is so much smaller than what we really are begins to allow the possibility of our nature's real power to emerge. Impermanence opens us to reality. It also opens us to compassion, because we realize that we are going to grow old and die. Everyone else will grow old and die, and nobody wants this any more than we do. So when we can recognize that other beings, even our enemies, they're going to die. They are going to suffer. We don't have to do anything. It's a big opening to compassion, as you may know, when Tsongkhapa teaches about compassion. He teaches about commenting on Chandrakirti, Madhyamagavatara, a famous verse, you know, compassion for beings seen as evanescent, like the moon and water, the waves rippling in water. In other words, understand compassion. We can have compassion for beings because they're suffering. That's one level. But in a way, a stronger level, an amped up level of compassion is to have compassion for other beings and ourselves whom we recognize as impermanent. that gives a little more torque to the compassion. That means our compassion is a little bit more right on the money of what's really going on. It's not just that they, you know, lost money in the stock market. It's not just that their best friend turned on them, partner deceived them. All of this is suffering, for surely. But they're impermanent. It's just another level that compassion can get to. And when we finally do get to reality itself is compassionate. This is a very powerful principle that Jigme Lingpa particularly brings forth, and having seen him bring it forth makes it easy to spot also in Longchenpa. So I'll just show you a few pictures, and then I'll tell you something else about Jigme Lingpa and do a guided meditation based on what he recommends. This is an old picture, I really don't recall where I got it from, of Samye and Samye Chimpuk, the mountains that I was talking about, where Guru Rinpoche and all these other great beings practiced, and still there are hundreds of people in the caves up there practicing. My teacher says it's the most sacred place in Tibet, so I just wanted to start with that, kind of like reminding us of Buddha nature. So in this, I think I might have talked about this verse here once before. Anyway, this is the verse of refuge that Jigme Lingpa writes in his, when he downloads the Dakini's yellow scrolls. It's a Nine-Yana teaching. And my point here is how Jigme Lingpa in this verse and also in the practice that we will do is bringing all of the nine yanas together, because they're actually not only a hierarchy, but in the way that Longchenpa and Jigme Lingpa teach, it seems fair enough to say that the whole, it's more like Dzogchen is in the center, and it's actually backlighting all of the other teachings. It's not just something you only get to at the top. In three real jewels, Buddha and Dharma and Sangha, three root bliss-filled ones, Guru, Deva, and Dakini, so that indicates the outer tantras. In the channels, winds, and bright orbs, Dzalung Tigle, that is in my subtle body, which is the mind of enlightenment. So these three phrases are refuges of the sutra vehicles, the outer tantras, and the inner tantras. Channels, winds, and bright orbs. And then essence, nature, moving love mandal. If you read Tibetan, you see Ngoma Rangsheng Tukche. This is, essence means empty essence. Nature means luminous, spontaneously occurring nature. And moving love mandal, this is what I wanted to point to. The actual Tibetan word there, which you can see if you read Tibetan down there, is Tukche, which is a common word for compassion, but here it doesn't mean compassion as the compassion that you cultivate and develop and so on. It means the natural responsiveness of the naked mind, the mind of open presence, the mind of sheer simplicity, the mind which fully recognizes its own nature, which is not an ordinary mind. Longchenpa says, I think this is so interesting, here's a koan, okay, chew on it for a long time. Only wisdom can know wisdom. Only wisdom knows itself. An amazing statement. And he actually says this in talking about Madhyamaka. He says it again in Dzogchen, but in the context of Madhyamaka, only wisdom knows wisdom. So we're not talking about ordinary mind here. The mandala of essence, nature, and compassionate responsiveness, the impermanence that we are practicing, yields finally to an experience of one's own real nature, real mind, real wisdom, and the essence of that is compassion. That's why the Buddhas are always spontaneously, naturally without giving any thought to it at all. Buddha has no thought, as you know. There's all direct experience, and their wisdom is always responding to the needs of living beings. So impermanence opens up us to the self-dissolving wisdom, to self-dissolving compassion, and finally to opens to reality itself, where we have this natural flow of responsiveness that's just naturally coming forth. So Jigme Lingpa's refuge here is a threefold refuge, that is to say the outer, inner, and secret jhanas. It's a nine-fold, nine-vehicle refuge. Of course, there's more that one can say about that, but for our purposes here, this is what we want to do. Okay. Longchenpa's seven trainings, which really go back to Garb Dorje's commentary on the only child scripture, so it's coming forth from a tantra. These are the topics, as I mentioned, impermanence, the adventitiousness of happiness, the multiple causes of death, where this really turns out to be a meditation on compassion, the third one, the fourth one, the meaninglessness of our worldly activities, reliance, which turns out to be a reflection on the importance of listening to a guru, fifth, reliance on the Buddha's good qualities, which turns out to be a determination to actually practice, and then sixth, to listen to the teacher's instructions, and finally, the non-conceptual meditations on bliss and emptiness, clarity and emptiness, and on reality itself, which culminates really in a kind of Dzogchen teaching. So right here in these seven trainings, we have, we could say, all nine vehicles, and what I am showing you is that impermanence itself, the way Jigme Lingpa leads us through a meditation on it, which we'll do in a moment, is nine vehicle. Again, my point is to say that this Dzogchen, this conviction in Buddha nature, is really backlighting every practice for a practitioner in this tradition, including the practices of impermanence, which, as we know, are there from the very beginning. It's one of the first meditations we do, like in Lamrim, right? Impermanence, very important. What am I doing wrong?
The other button.
No. I did the other button. Okay. Well, this is more than I can really talk about today, but a lovely picture here. This is Longchenpa's view, actually, when he meditated at Kangri Tugar, just down the river from Samye Chimpuk, behind Shuksep Dzogchen Nunnery. This literally was his view. So, vast expanse. Whoops. Ah, yes. So, one of the reasons that the meditation with the body, which is what comes in the seventh contemplation, you imagine the body in various ways, is so important, or any of the practices that you do, Vajrasattva practice, Tantra practice, that you work with the body, imagining it filling with light, becoming purified, emanating light from your heart, many, many practices that we have that have to do with the body. So from this perspective, I think very interesting, Longchenpa says that supreme primordial wisdom abides in the body. It's actually everywhere. And so these practices, from this perspective, a discovery perspective, the practices that are working with our body are actually waking up the wisdom that is there. We don't realize that it's present in the body, but it is. Oops. How can I go back? Oops. Okay. Okay, I might ask you to help me get that last slide at the end, but not now. I don't need it now. All right. So when Jigme Lingpa comments on how to actually meditate on impermanence, he says this very interesting thing. He says, well, people who are well, studied and kind of mature practitioners, they might do very well studying scripture. But a lot of people need a story. And so he gives a story. as the meditation. I'm going to give you a version of that story and ask you, are you in the mood? and ask you, so this is how, this is a meditation on impermanence, okay? So take a moment to kind of, you know, come into your own space and be aware of the full screen of your own mind and being, and sit as you would sit in meditation. And so the scene changes. Your inner movie is going into a new reel. And you are seated right now in a completely desolate place. You have no idea where you are. You have no idea how you got there. There is a fierce wind blowing dust everywhere. There is no sign of human companionship anywhere. You're just alone. You don't know what to do. And you're sitting there in your misery and your confusion. And a woman and a man come by, and they say to you, hey, we're going to an island which has an amazing jewel. Want to come? Well, this interests you. And so you go along with them, and you set off on a ship in the ocean. And as you cross deeper and deeper into the ocean, it becomes more and more of a nightmare. The swells in the sea that seemed so charming to begin with are now rising like a 10, 15, 25 story building. Your little boat rises in the top of these waves and then is plunged down into the valley of the trough of the wave when it collapses. You begin to fear for your life. And if that weren't bad enough, there are incredible monsters like you've never seen before. Eight-headed monsters, fish with a horse's head, big teeth, unimaginable creatures are passing by day and night. And the storm winds rise greater and greater. Time has passed. You've gotten older and older. You still haven't reached the jeweled island. And all of a sudden, the storm becomes incredibly intense. The oars that the men and the women are using to try to steer the boat through the torrent, the oars are broken. They crack, they disappear into a whirlpool. The boat itself starts to crack apart, and you, who have never until this moment given any thought to your own mortality, cry out in fear. You realize the time of your death is upon you. You have made no preparations. You call out in your desperation, your misery, your anguish, your fear. And suddenly, dancing gently before you in space is your luminous lama, Gurimpache, Tongkapa. Your lama is there and says to you, my dear child, this is what happens. You have wasted your life. You thought that some sorrow was a jewel that you could capture. The man and the woman who drew you into this journey, they are your own artificial and innate ignorance. You have been badly deceived. And now you have come to the very end. What will you do? Your desperation knows no bounds. The boat itself flips over. Your mind leaves your body. And from the heart of your luminous lama is extended a web of radiant light which touches your heart. And as you leave your body, You are drawn by this luminous latticework of light into the luminous, enlightened heart and mind of your own beloved teacher, and you yourself experience enlightenment. And now you have become a guide for all beings suffering in the ocean of samsara like you did, and you send out light from your heart to all of the beings in all of the realms who are suffering from heat and cold, hunger, fear, desire, jealousy, pride. And you send light to all of the realms and bless and Buddhify all of the beings in all of those realms, purifying the whole of cyclic existence, the whole of your experience. And then letting go of all of that completely. Just letting your mind be at ease. Whether your mind is active or still, you're simply present to the natural condition of your own mind. And let go of even that. And just take a moment to digest the experience. Always good at the end of a meditation session, even a short one. And so you're not trying to do anything. You're just sitting there with yourself very simply and noticing how this process has impacted you, what your experience is right now. And you just take stock, digest for a moment. And when you're ready, come back to the room. So, that's kind of a nine-vehicle journey. In a very essentialized way of thinking about impermanence and the need to realize, really consider what is of value in your life, sutra teachings, the connection with and dissolving into the luminous lama, the guru, really the essence of tantric teachings, identifying as an enlightened being. And then finally, that very last little bit of just kind of resting in your own mind. Jigme Lingpa gives five little instructions like that in the course of his commentary. And they're very simple instructions. If one has had Dzogchen instructions, they really are Dzogchen. They're a portal to Dzogchen or Dzogchen themselves. So in that way, he seems to, just in that very short, seems to show how the three vehicles, we can say sutra, tantra, and Dzogchen, are really work together. And you can actually unify them in a single session, just like he does in his refuge prayer that we looked at earlier, and just as he does in this practice. So that's what I wanted to share with you. I feel it's a very beautiful thing that you're not, this is a whole, the teaching is a whole, you know. We might emphasize one part of it more than another, depending on where we're at. Of course we do that. But it doesn't mean we're not, in this kind of logos, it doesn't mean that we're not already in touch with, backlit by the highest teachings on our true nature, no matter what practice we're doing. So we have a few minutes if you have some comments, questions, disagreements. How is that meditation? It was short, but, yeah. Huh? It's amazing, isn't it? Yeah. He's got a couple like that in the... Yeah. And then, of course, a further step would be, once really familiar with his story is, you know, he could start creating a story for you that worked for you. Although I personally find this quite compelling. Every time I say it, it's like, oh no, what am I going to do? Yeah. Speechless? Yeah, no, okay.
I found myself thinking as you were speaking earlier about development of the lifespan of how children, young children come in. So in that place of myself, didn't even know they're in it. They're just in it, watching my son grow. It, you know, like discovering this. I remember 1 year, he and all his friends start talking about what they like.
I am. Yes,
this,
yes.
Because I like this.
Yes,
or
yes.
I like that. Or
yes.
I'm good at this. Or,
yeah.
You know, this development of identity. And then we circle around and try to loosen ourselves from
Right. Yeah, it's very true. It's nice. So that, I guess you could take that as another indication of what our real nature is like. You know, we may not have been born fully realizing selflessness in a way that we can really hold it through a lifetime when all these other pressures come in, but still prior to that conditioning, a little bit more of that freedom is available. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
So I have a question about our eternal nature. I mean, kind of it's hammered home that nothing is, there is no such thing as eternally anything. Everything is always moving and changing, and yet we have this eternal nature, this Buddha nature within us. And so, I mean, is that in itself really eternally only something, or is that, at some point, is our Buddha nature moving towards something even greater that we don't understand?
It's a subtle point. One way to talk about it, and this is, there are different ways. One way is to say that, not that it's permanent in the sense of there's no like one, it's still get shikma, there's one moment and there's another moment. But in this case, every moment is just like the one before it. So ontologically, it's still the same kind of dependent arising, you might say, but it's different because it continues in the same way. So one way to talk about it. Another way to talk about it sometimes is to say that Longchenpa and Jigme Lingpa after him says that the Dharmakaya is a kind of fusion of the Dharmadhatu, basic space or spacious matrix or infinite womb. It's translated different ways, but Dharma Dhatu and primordial wisdom. And as we saw, Longchenpa says wisdom is everywhere. So wisdom is everywhere, not just in our heads or even just in our bodies. It's everywhere. And the Dharma Dhatu is everywhere. And wisdom is infusing this Dharma Dhatu. So it's almost like the sky, in some sense, never changes. The lack of obstructive contact aspect of the sky never changes. But light shines through it, and the light may show differently. So sometimes they talk about it like that, that there's kind of this definitive unchanging, but it is totally suffused with something, you know, the five Buddha, the lights and so on, the Buddha wisdom shines through that. So those are two ways of talking about it. Yeah, it's a subtle point. Yes?
This may seem a little far out. It's not how I usually think about the Dharma. But there's the science mind and the another kind of mind. And when you were talking about the compassion for the impermanence of the moon and mountains, the image I got was of compassion for the movement of the entire universe. Mm. I'm not used to thinking of the universe as sentient.
Oh, interesting.
Because I got them separated in one moment.
Right.
So I wonder if you had any comment on that.
Oh, that's quite interesting. I don't know what I actually said that game. Because what I was thinking of, there's this famous, Chandrakirti talks about like the ripples in water or the moon in water, and he uses that as an example for the impermanence of living beings and the emptiness of living beings. He's not actually saying that you have compassion for the moon and the water, although I feel that's very sweet, actually. I mean, why should your compassionate heart, which is infinitely expansive, you know, stop at the door of the moon or something like that? So I feel that's very sweet. But just to clarify what I was trying to say is that it's seeing beings, other people, and yourself. We are all like ripples on the lake, because we are always gechikma, we are always changing. And that's poignant, you know, that's just poignant. The being you love most in this world, they're mortal. Mm-hmm. You know, it's tender. Yeah. Yes. Well, you know, that's the dangerous thing. When you've just had a meditation that was very strong for you and you think you're going to recapture it by having another meditation, quote, just like it, just be careful. It doesn't work that way. I don't know if we really have time to. Okay, we'll do one thing. We'll close with one thing, okay? Yes?
When you explain the primordial wisdom,
yes.
Is that
yes,
primordial she. Awareness is the wisdom,
yes,
or the emptiness, or the luminosity? Is everything together is the wisdom, or the primordial awareness is separate from a primordial wisdom?
I'm not making a distinction. I'm just talking about yeshe. That's the word that Longchenpa uses when he says that primordial wisdom is infuses the Dharma Dhatu. He's talking about yeshe, usually translated as primordial wisdom. So I'm not making a distinction. But later he will equate that in a Dzogchen way with Rigpa, which is sometimes translated as open presence, or even with the mind of enlightenment itself, with Jangchup Sem, in a very ultimate sense. I'm not sure if I know what you're asking.
I mean, awareness itself is the wisdom more.
Yeah, you could say that. Not ordinary awareness, of course. Non-dualistic, completely open awareness is
but
wisdom.
Awareness itself is also sannyata and also emptiness and also the luminosity altogether.
If you're talking in terms of Dzogchen terminology, they might say that. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Is that what you're asking? Yeah, there are places where they will say that. Then there's also the possibility of talking about emptiness as emptiness, but they will say things like emptiness really is, but it's emptiness fused with spontaneous presence, flundrup, you know, the essence, nature. So reality, as our essential mind of open presence, is on the one hand empty, which is basically teachings on emptiness, primordial purity, but it's not just empty. And Jigme Lingpa likes to say that. There is, it has some kind of radiance, and that's what the nature is, that luminous nature. But you can't separate them, but you can talk about them a little bit differently.
Yeah, I understand you say the essence is the emptiness, and mm-hmm. nature is the
luminosity, and the spontaneous.
And the spontaneous,
both.
Compassionate is combined to that.
Yes, that's right. Good, yes. Yes.
I have one or two favorite stories. Transmission of mind, or so general, it's between great teachers and students. I'm thinking, for instance, of Gampopa and Miller Abrams, Miller Abrams walking over the past for the last time.
Uh-huh.
A couple of those stories that have really stayed with you since you first heard them or experienced them.
So Jigme Lingpa was right, right? People want stories. A great teacher. I don't know if it's a great story, but it made a great impression on me. One time, Atsen Rinpoche just kind of stood up. I don't remember anymore where we were. He stood up and he said, I love all beings of all six realms. Wow. I never heard that kind of thought before. we're supposed to develop compassion for all living beings. And you could just tell that, you know, he really did, and that they were all, like, vivid in front of him at that moment. At least that's what I felt. So that was a nice moment. I heard about a moment that I didn't witness. I think I read it on Facebook, actually. Apparently, it's a famous moment of Trungpa and Dingwa Khenze Rinpoche sitting together. Maybe you know the story. Maybe you we're Facebook friends. You saw. Anyway, they're sitting together for a long time. You know, great beings, whatever great beings do when they sit together, and their mind wisdom melds, and who knows what they were communicating. And all of a sudden, Trungpa Rinpoche bursts out laughing, and just hysterical. And he points. He says, "And people call that a tree." I thought it was great because I was just reading something in Longchenpa, I think it's somewhere in Chuangzi, where he says, you know, we talk about, at least this is how I understand it, we talk a lot about the wonders of the enlightened mind and all of the great magnificence of enlightenment and how just totally out of sight all of that is. But really, if you think about it, it is amazing that whereas there is actually nothing but wisdom and space and luminosity, we think, you know, that there are tables and chairs and clothing and all the stuff that we get all mired in. And isn't that, he goes on and on, he says, isn't that more amazing than the amazing? Isn't that more stunning than the stunning? And finally, you get a little bit pried away from what seems totally normal, you know? Oh, wow, that is kind of strange, that there's actually nothing like that anywhere. But we're all convinced that there is, and isn't that wild? So I had the idea on the airplane today to put this up in case you'd like to stay in touch. I'm Facebook and Carolyn, one word, Klein, if you want to be friends. And Dawn Mountain, we have downloadable teachings, including teachings actually on the seven mind trainings, if you're interested. And we have Teaching Tuesdays that are broadcast or later downloadable. And I mean, you have a wealth of richness here, so I don't know but why you would, but if you do, you know, someday there's nothing going on here, and you, or anyway, just to add to more riches, if you would like to be in touch, those are ways to, Dawn Mountain is also on Facebook. You're welcome to like Dawn Mountain on Facebook. That's our center in Houston. And then you will hear about things that we have. If there's anybody, actually, I just thought of this now. Do people here do Nyandro? Do you do the foundational practices? Yeah, anybody who's finished them? Sorry. Okay. Then never mind. If you have, let me know. Okay, I think, is somebody official going to come and say anything? Or should I say something? Oh. I was, huh?
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Such a treat to have you here.
Thank you.
Telling stories.
Telling stories, yes.
Talking about philosophy and scholarship as well, and the model of your being a scholar practitioner in the world is so important for us.
Oh, thank you.
A guide and inspiration.
Oh, thank you. Well. Thank you.
And on behalf of Yasser Rinpoche, I'd like to reiterate his request that
thank
you please return many
oh,
times
thank you.
To
Maitripa.
Thank and you. Thank you so much you. For the generosity of flying into the airport, running to Portland State, there, running to Maitripa, and now taking off to lead a Green Tower retreat this weekend. So I'm just so privileged that it worked out for this afternoon.
I'm happy that it worked out and you were flexible, and thank you for getting the PowerPoint. And you know, I always like it when I come here. I'm always kind of tired because I've always just flown in, but you guys are great, and I know that wonderful, wonderful things are happening here. I have a lot of respect and affection for Rinpoche. Very nice to make a little time. We just had a little bit of a chat, even though he's not feeling well. So, and these are my roots too, you know, so I feel I'm very happy that Maitripa is growing and becoming another place for Dharma in this country, in this part of the country, is really, really important. So. And we will do one closing thing. Should I take this first?
Yes, please.
Okay. So, what do I do?
Sorry.
Okay, well, thank you. Another shot?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So, as a concise, essential indication both of the vastness of our nature, the vastness of our compassion, and our orientation always to practice in a way that is of benefit to all beings. Would just take a moment. Go back into your sitting. Just takes a moment. You're already sitting. There's nothing to do, really. And whatever understanding that you have gained through your life of practice, perhaps particularly this afternoon, but really all of the capacity of your mind. The mind, as she knows, is Selshin Rigpa, it's clarity, right? That's an intrinsic capacity of every mind. So allow that clarity to arise as an orb of light. It's your clarity. It's not like you're imposing anything, but just naturally there's an orb of light at your heart, just expressing your nature, your luminous nature. And there's a luminous white awe in the center of that, expressing the vast expanse. Awe is often said to be an expression of emptiness, of reality itself. And the essence of wisdom of reality is compassion. And so we're going to sound one single awe. And you're sending your light, your loving attention, and of course, the vibration of awe itself, expanding from your heart to your body, to everyone in the room, to everyone across Portland, across the Pacific, China, mainland, the whole back east, the Atlantic. In other words, by the end of the awe, just like that, you have encompassed the whole universe with the blessings of your intention for benefit to arise wherever space exist. Okay, so as long as we continuously refresh that intention, now we're doing all right. Okay, thank you, everybody. Keep up the good work. Hope to see you again. Practice. Doesn't happen automatically. Training.